I'm Alfonso Winker.
And I'm Trina Olson. And together, we're the co-founders of Team Dynamics.
And this is Behave. Trina, I'm really excited for today's episode of Behave. We've been talking for a long time about getting more of our team, our staff, our contractors onto Behave to talk about issues and topics that are important to them, aspects of identity and culture that impact the way we do our work together. And so today, our teammate Pearl is joining us to have a conversation about the concept of colorism.
Woohoo! I am so excited as well. This is such an important topic and conversation, and I really do believe that we have a dream team, and the fact that we have assembled this crew of people at this time, I'm really excited because I get to do a bunch of work with Pearl. So I'm excited to have the conversation today. Should we start a little bit as we are introducing, reminding folks who may be new to Behave, or just getting folks grounded in the identities that the three of us have as we start to talk about colorism?
Yeah, let's do that. And since Pearl, you're our guest on the show, let's have you just start talking about a little bit who you are, how you identify, aspects of your identity that are important to you that you bring to your work.
Yeah. So here's parts of my identity that I've been sharing in different places and spaces lately that I would love to share with you all as well. So one, what is really important to me is that my name Pearl, my name connects me to my grandmother, and then it also connects me to my great-great-grandmother. The other parts of my identity that really have meaning for me are that I am a caregiver. I care for my mother, who is partially abled body and partially disabled body. And also, I racially identify as Black. I am a female. My preferred pronouns are she and her. And I just fundamentally believe that we have capacity to grow and evolve. So that's a little bit about me. How about the both of you?
Thanks, Pearl. So I am white. I am 40. I am queer. And I was raised Christian. So I think those all really impact how I think about my programming and my training and what I learned was right and wrong, and some of the misinformation that has gotten into my body and my cells and what I have been praised for and punished for over time. Alfonso.
Thanks, y'all. I talk about myself as third generation Mexican-American. I talk about myself as Latino. Sometimes I've dabbled with the concept of Chicano identity. For anyone that's listened, I've been on this maybe years-long journey of trying to connect to language that accurately captures for me my sense of self. I'm a cisgender man. I use he and him pronouns. I'm a queer person. I'm a gay man. And I think a lot about the fact that I'm also single and I'm not currently parenting any young people. And I think a lot about that because on our team and a lot of the relationships I'm in, there are folks who are choosing parenting and are choosing being coupled as a way to sort of build and create family. And I think as we talk about colorism today, which we're about to try to give some texture or some structure to as a concept or as a force or system, I think that there are ways that as a masculine presenting light skinned person, I do and don't have to think about what people's expectations about the sort of familial roles I play, or sort of, am I a leader? Am I a parent? Am I a number of different things? So I think lightness and darkness of skin layers onto how I get treated as it connects to other aspects of my identity. So I wanted to bring those pieces in.
So one of the things I think that could ground our conversation today is that we have a resource that we share with anybody who's interested in working with us. And it's, you know, the tersest tightest way, I think it's about two pages, that we could put our race and racism analysis down on paper for folks to understand sort of our directionality, our vantage point, our focus areas. So Alfonso, would you be willing to read from our race and racism analysis what we wrote and how we ground ourselves in conversations about the reality of the existence of colorism and the impact of colorism inside of conversations about race and racism?
Absolutely. And of course, all of our thinking, our perspective is really grounded in our studies of authors and activists, folks like Gloria Anzaldúa, Sherry Moraga, Angela Davis, bell hooks, Audre Lorde, John Powell, Bobby Seale. So when we compiled our analysis, it was really about what we've gleaned from what we were taught through the lens of those scholars and activists and thought leaders. And so when we talk about colorism, we start from a premise that we know that a very real and pervasive anti-blackness exists within the US as a construct and within institutions inside of the US as a construct. And we know that lighter skin gets privileged and that has impacts around access, around influence. And it's our responsibility to disrupt that. And in addition to anti-Black colorism, we also understand that Indigenous people, all sorts of people of color, we experience the pitfalls of colorism in our work and in how we relate to one another, and really in the ways in which we get to claim identity and connect to each other. I think colorism really seeks to keep us separate from one another. And I think also is a bit of a project to keep us proximate or far away from the benefits of whiteness or white performance. So went a little bit off our resource there, but if you want to read a little bit more about how we understand the construction of race and racism, you can check out teamdynamicsmn.com/tools. We've been talking a bunch. Let's get warmed up with Pearl, with your perspective. When we say this word colorism as a system, a force, a concept, a construct, a layer, how do you view that?
Yeah, thank you, Alfonso. And so what comes to mind when I think about colorism is some words from a man of color located right here in Minnesota. What first stands out to me is that the white body is the standard in which all things are measured. So these are words offered up from a Black man, Resmaa Menakem, that is located here in our Minnesota community. And then what I also want to share is that according to Dr. Yaba Blay, there is a lived reality that white body supremacy creates a hierarchy, a binary between white and Black. So amongst those of us not white, we're going to create our own hierarchy. That hierarchy, the categorization, the classification, and the sorting and othering is about proximity to whiteness. And so whiteness is human, and being Black represents not being human. So my value of humanness is then evaluated based on the amount of whiteness I have. Whiteness makes folks more human. Also, in the words of Dr. Yaba Blay, colorism is a symptom of white body supremacy. And so the role of colonialism is to divide and rule. Colorism is an attempt to gain access to the power and privilege afforded to whiteness based on our ability to approximate to whiteness. It's an attempt, again, to gain access to the power that has been consolidated with whiteness. In a documentary, Light Girls, I really learned that whiteness sells. Whiteness sells toothpaste, it sells cars, it sells products and services. And so colorism is the discriminatory treatment of individuals falling within the same racial group on the basis of skin color. It operates both intra-racially and inter-racially. Intra-racially, colorism occurs when members of a racial group make distinctions based upon skin color between members of their own race. Interracial colorism occurs when members of one racial group make distinctions based on skin color between members of another racial group. That was offered by Cedric Hearing, Verner Keith, Hayward Horton, and the article is Skin Deep, How Race and Complexion Matter in the Color Blind Era. So actually, I do want to toss a question back to you, Alfonso. I'm wondering, in what ways have you experienced colorism?
Thank you, Pearl. I'm just appreciating the grounding, you know, hearing you talk about concentration of power, proximity to whiteness. It just gives me a lot of self-reflection. And I think the first way that I know that I've benefited from colorism is an example I often give when I train with our colleague, Tyree, who is a Black woman, queer Black woman. And I use us as an example. And I say, let's say you wanted to, quote, diversify your team. And often we say diversity to stand in for we want more people of color, right? Which then means folks of color are other from, right? If we're diverse from whiteness, right? Let's say you wanted to diversify your team, and Tyree and I came and we have the same qualifications, the same qualities, a lot of the same personality characteristics. Our capability to do the job is equal or on par. Because of colorism, it's more likely that you're going to pick me. There's a bunch of gender stuff for sure at play in terms of preference for masculinity. And also my lightness and my proximity to whiteness is likely more palatable to a white dominant system or workplace. And so one of the ways I've experienced colorism is the ways in which I get to be the brown person in the room because of my light skin. So it feels more comfortable, right? I feel like, to put it through sort of your framework that you shared, Pearl, I might feel more human to white leadership, to white dominance, to white systems. Whereas a darker skin or a Black body feels less human, farther away from, less controllable, right? I think that the darker, the more needed to be controlled in a white system. So I think that's how I've benefited from. I think how I've been close to other folks with light skin and dark skin who sort of share my ethnicity is in sort of in-grouping and out-grouping and really creating distance within Latino or Latinx community about who belongs or who doesn't, right? When we sort of do networking events or affinity-based space, there is sometimes this undertone or awareness that a space is or isn't for Afro-Latino folks, for example. Or we might have particular nicknames or derogatory phrasing that we use to talk about one another's lightness or darkness within, you know, you talk that inter or intra, right? And then the other way that I've really thought about it is my desire to be read as a Mexican-American person. And so part of how colorism works for me is not wanting to pass as white. And so I spend as much time as I can in the summer outside so that I can look more bronze or golden so that folks read me, especially in Minnesota, because we're in a white dominant state. I think there's a desire to sort of categorize people as close to whiteness as possible. And so I've been in spaces where people might sort of decide that I'm not a person of color, or might decide that I maybe am not Latino, but maybe I'm Italian, or any number of other things. And it's funny, Trina's told this story probably on the show before, but then when we go to California, right away, folks, you know, in the airport, when we land, if we're taking an Uber, if we're at a restaurant, if we're maybe at a community organization, folks start speaking to me in Spanish automatically and actually don't speak Spanish fluently. So I think there's just a lot of layers to, for me, how I experience being in this particular body. And Pearl, I'm wondering if we could bring Trina in just to sort of share some of her observations of how she sees this play out. We're on a mixed team across race and ethnicity, across lightness and darkness. And so I'm curious, from that vantage point of being a white leader who's trying to pay attention to colorism, Trina, like, what comes up for you?
Mm, Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you both for including me in the conversation. And I want to name that as we got ready for this episode, I was like, do we want sort of a white perspective as part of this, or should I just get the fuck out of the way? Right. So I appreciate that this feels like it might add value. A couple of things were coming up for me. So Pearl, as you were talking about the deep dehumanization as a project, right, and how colorism plays that out, I'm thinking a lot about my experience and my white body of the propaganda that I have consumed over 40 years, mainly under the guise of whose bodies are dangerous and whose aren't, right? And everything from the local news to major media to social media to interview processes, right? Just this idea of darkness being conflated with danger. And I happen to be in a white cisgendered woman body, and the preciousness of white women bodies being leveraged and weaponized as the most important bodies to protect, right, for centuries. So I'm just sitting with this conflation of comfort and safety and how colorism plays this really critical role in the project of subjugation by race. Right. So I'm partly thinking about that. The second thing I was thinking about is, Alfonso, while you were talking, as we think about supporting workplaces, a lot of workplaces really understandably want to believe that they behave in a way that is in accordance with being a meritocracy. So the idea that we're just, you know, hiring the most competent or qualified person, or that person did break the rules, so we do have to start disciplinary proceedings, or here's who is readiest to be on stage or speak to the media, or just whatever folks are getting pulled into. And I think about the organizations that I've worked at and which bodies have had which leadership roles. I actually feel really lucky is maybe the word, but I have a lot of experience following the lead of Black folks and of dark-skinned leaders. And also, those leaders were always very overt about how much extra work they had to do. And so I think about a canvas director who had to go over the top and wave before he ever knocked on anybody's door to raise money, because he knew that people in Seattle had been conditioned to believe that he was dangerous by just being in his body. So I just think about being in proximity to folks across different shades and hues and sort of what that's been like. The last thing that's sort of coming up for me right this minute is how there is this obsession right now with what I will call the United Colors of Benetton photo that organizations seem to think they want to have. So we have watched major fashion companies, major brands, major media companies ethnically and racially diversify their casting, right? And Alfonso, you and I have actually talked about this. There's a whole category of casting for commercials known as people who read as racially ambiguous. And the idea that that would play really good in a lot of markets, because if people think, oh, maybe you're Jewish, maybe you're North African or Middle Eastern, maybe you are Italian, right? So this idea that with the continued racially mixing globe that we're living on, I think folks are using colorism as an additional way to sort and rank order, because folks are having a harder time correctly guessing lineage, family experience, tradition, cultural preferences by looking at people. And so I think the cultural code of lightness and darkness still seems to really be playing like a scale against which we can clearly measure. Well, the rest of the scale seem to be sort of crumbling and confusing to people. So this feels like one of those last vestiges of rank ordering that feels, you know, the word in my mind was like clean or clear or just like about our senses. So we don't have to use our mind. We're just, for those of us who have sight, able to go, nope, darkest to lightest, here's how we would line folks up.
It, you know, it makes me think about, I think we were having a conversation recently, not on behave, but just the two of us, about like Rashida Jones playing an Italian person on The Office. Right?
Like her a gazillion character. Seasons ago. Yep.
And you're like, yep, that is a person who is a mixed Black person. Mm-hmm. We've covered a lot of ground already, folks. I think I want to invite everyone who's listening to take a breath and just to notice what's happening. Maybe as you listen to the three of us frame up how we experience colorism, there were, you know, shoulders rising or tummies clenching or warmth in the face or some yeah buts running through your head or second guessing every hire that you've ever made. So just settle into that and take a few breaths. And we'll take a break. And when we come back, Pearl and Trina, maybe let's talk about how do we uproot colorism in our daily practices.
Why can't you behave? Oh, why can't you behave?
Welcome back. Thank you for sticking with us as we continue to work to disentangle and go deeper and hopefully add some value and some layers onto some wondering, some curiosity, some conversations you may have been in recently around the impacts of colorism on you, your family, your community, your workplace, and more. So, Pearl, in our work together, you know, you and I talk about how we have yet to discover quick fixes for most things that have to do with prejudice, discrimination, harassment. This is about a clearing from the cellular training that all of our bodies have experienced around this preference toward lightness and whiteness and this attempt to skew or move away or dehumanize darkness. So, Pearl, for you in your practice right now, how are you doing that self-awareness wrestle to catch when colorism is arising in you, when you are experiencing it? How are you interrupting or trying to pump the brakes when you are witnessing, hearing, experiencing, whether it's internal and external, colorism in your orbit?
Yeah, I'm probably going to share quite a bit of words. And it's my hope that something lands or a piece of this lands. So I heard, again, Dr. Yaba Blay say, it's not that simple to just choose who we are. You know, I heard her share that identity is complicated. Identity is the meaning of who you are, who you believe yourself to be, and it's also who others tell you you are. Ooh, wrestling with that, right? So the reality is I sit and navigate the complexity and strive to reconnect with the pure essence of who I am internally. The who I am or the part of me, the being at my core that has never been harmed, that has never been diminished, and that part of me that is alive within, but just unfortunately has layers and layers and layers and layers of different tropes and messages and narratives thrown on top of it that I'm kind of digging and digging to rediscover that part of me. And so it's also the part of me on the inside who is endlessly creative, generative, and engaged in the world. And so I'm sitting with that complexity while I also navigate a societal experience and external context that values me when you zoom out based on my race, based on my gender, and when you zoom in just a little bit more, based on the color of my skin, based on my hair texture, based on my tone of voice, based on my features, and much, much more. So it's like I'm really sitting with the complexity of both of that. I'm striving internally to get back to the core of who I am, and yet externally, I'm still navigating the reality of the lived experience that we lived in. So how do I do my work of uprooting all this, what I say is ish, that I have absorbed over the years? I slow down and ask myself some reflection questions. Have I ever, or when, or is this a moment when I've judged another person or questioned another person's ethnicity or identity based on their skin tone or their language? Have I ever challenged another Black person or another person of color for showing up in spaces that I deemed appropriate only for certain types of Black people or certain types of people of color? Have I ever, you know, used terms toward other folks? Like, have I referenced the color of their skin? I know growing up, I was often referred to as high yellow, or I was told that I, quote unquote, act white or sound white. And so I pause to think about, have I done that to anyone else? Have I a term or made a statement or assumption about them based on their, again, their skin tone or their language and so forth? And so the other piece to my work is learning to love myself like a revolutionary. And that process is not being at war with the color of my skin and not being at war with the color of other skin. Specifically for folks in the Black community, it's also not being at war with other people in the Black community. And then there's quotes that I often hold on to and reflect upon that I would love to read with the group. Both quotes are by Audre Lorde, but one of the quotes I hold on to is, we cannot love our people unless we love each of ourselves, unless I love each piece of myself. Those I wish to keep and those I wish to change. For survival is the ability to encompass this, to encompass change without destruction. And the other quote that I hold on to is, we have to consciously study how to be tender with each other until it becomes a habit. So I'm practicing how I can become tender, not only with myself, with other folks as well. And that practice, you know, it doesn't feel good all the time, but it's still worth the journey. And then lastly, it's like I'm resting in my spirit and holding myself in a way that I can continue on the journey towards self-liberation by doing the digging, like getting back to the pearl who I said, the essence of who Pearl is. Right. So I'm resting in my spirit that I am going to get there, and I'm going to continue to do my work to get there as well. I hope that helps. Alfonso, I'm curious to hear, what are you working on and how are you working on it?
Well, thank you, Pearl. I loved listening to you, and Pearl got to watch me run across the room and grab a book that I got reminded of. So thank you for that reminder. For me, I sort of think in bullet pointed lists. So there's three things, and I'll try to give an example. The first is, for me, my self-awareness work around race and ethnicity ended up needing to be grounded in history. And history and data is not always the first place to start self-awareness work. But for me, I needed a deeper understanding of the relationship between what we now call the North American continent and Spain and Spaniards and sort of Spanish colonization and the act of bringing Catholicism to the Western Hemisphere, right? And for me, that was an exploration of, or the genesis of sort of a mestizo race, which was indigenous, quote, Mexicans, right? What we now call Mexicans, sort of mixed with Spanish blood, which is where the lightning of Mexican folks came from, right? It was European colonization. And then as we arbitrarily drew the borders between the US and Mexico, some mestizos got ingrouped into the American identity, and other mestizos got grouped into being sort of a Mexican national identity. And I come from that line, and my people were on both sides of that border drawing. And so Gloria Anzaldúa in her book Borderlands actually talks about how we spiritually sort of exist in that place of being mixed. And for any of us raised or living in the US, American identity beckons us to proximity to whiteness for political and economic advantage. That there's a lot of forces in the US that work to draw Latino folks into political and economic advantage by being proximal to whiteness. And so I just have to situate myself inside that history to say that there's a project at play that sees me as a pawn for political and economic benefit to uphold white supremacy, right? The second is then for me to not fight with that truth, but just to say it's true and it's in me and it's in my line. And the truth is I'm supposed to see myself separate from in any sort of indigenous roots. And I'm supposed to see myself as separate from Black folks in particular. And so like, that's just true. So for me, the third piece is then notice how my choices reinforce that project or don't. And every day I make choices that reinforce that sort of project of being proximate to whiteness. And every day I make choices to move away from it. And so I think I just have to take stock of those choices and say, okay, are there choices? Are there things I can undo? Like, what is in my control? Are there choices I've made that can't be undone? Are there things I need to repair? Are there next times when I can make the choice differently and not get caught up in there's nothing I can do, but there's something I can do? So that's sort of my practice. Trina, for you, what's your practice?
Well, thank you both for bringing your clarity and your wrestle and your deep knowing into the conversation. So there's a couple layers from me of what's really in front of mind for me right now, or is really conscious. So part of it is to be a better receiver of messages and to really think about anti-racism as a moment-to-moment responsibility when I am being shown images that dark is bad, that dark is less intelligent, that dark is more distant, that dark is dangerous, right? So I try hard to catch, and I know still a lot, if I think about it kind of like a sieve, I know a lot is still making it through. And so part of my job is to notice all the ways in which I am being conditioned or brainwashed to believe that innocence or purity is connected to whiteness and that there is an opposite and it's related to skin color, right? So part of it is being really responsible as a consumer and trying to get better and better at catching more stuff in my sieve. The other layer for me is just the reminder that spiritually, physically, because I reject everything to do with the junk science and the eugenics around the idea of a master race and how many times garbage around the idea of a master race has led to murder and genocide and the attempted execution of whole races of people. I think for me, as somebody who benefits minute by minute, hour by hour from my own whiteness, it's about continuing to do that reckoning and to not hold on to that, which could just feel really comfy about the fact that I seem to have been born in a body that is likable because I have light hair, light eyes, light skin. And so what it's like to look in the mirror and wrestle with a body that is mine that I didn't pick, and the moment-to-moment responsibility to listen and really learn from what it's like to be with my friends and my neighbors and my colleagues at the airport, in a car when law enforcement is pulling somebody over, at the bank when somebody's applying for a mortgage, in a hiring room. So this recognition that this rank ordering is happening everywhere. And then also in my coaching work to help folks notice, not only have you done sort of a head count of who you think is here, But let's also talk about and notice lightness and darkness. Let's notice if there are dark-skinned folks in leadership, if there are dark-skinned folks having higher turnover at your organization. Do you know, not just the demographics, but do you know lightness to darkness? Is there a bias about who is doing better in this workplace and who isn't? And remembering that won't be accidental if there is a pattern.
Well, I just have so much gratitude for both of you and for this conversation. Pearl, thank you for being a part of today's episode and kicking off what's going to be a few months in a row of welcoming in team members into the Behave podcast. As we always say, folks, we want to hear from you on Twitter. Send us a tweet at Behave Podcast. We want to hear about how you're thinking about navigating colorism. Thanks for hanging out. Wash your hands, wear a mask, and make good choices.